go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you.
Good morning, good morning. Praise the Lord. It's good to be here in this fallish weather. Amen?
Amen.
Well, I just want to draw your attention to the bulletin, and if you don't have one, make sure you raise your hand and we'll get one to you. Also, what we're trying to do is to get everyone to share their cell phone number with us. So today, if you can help us out by tearing this little card off. And even if you think we already have your information, I think most people here are regular attenders and members, just fill it out anyway. Put your cell number in there. We're not going to sell it to the highest bidder. We want the cell number so that when we have something that we need to communicate to the body, it gets to you quicker. Most people do not take the time to read their email, right? It's kind of like, Maybe the husband thinks the wife's reading it, the wife thinks the husband's reading it, and then no one really reads it, right? And so if we can send a text message to everybody just reminding somebody about something, or let's say we cancel the service because of the snow, best way to communicate that it will be through a text message. So please take the time today, fill it out, and get your cell number on there and put it in the offering plate when that comes by in a few moments, all right? Let me pray, and we'll have a time of greeting, and then we'll continue singing unto the Lord. Father, we give you praise and thanks for your goodness to us. Thank you for each one here. I pray, God, that your spirit would move in all of our hearts, that you would help us to see how glorious you are, Jesus, and that whatever is going on in our lives, you will reveal to us the beauty of Christ, the majesty, the splendor, the treasure that Jesus ought to be to all of us will be exalted and lifted up in our affections, that we would love you more today than we did yesterday, and we will continue to grow in our love for you. We give you praise. We give you thanks for all that you're doing. Thank you, Lord Jesus, and bless this time in this service. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Walk around and greet one another. We're going to go.
Hello.
Sorry. Oops. Just with you, Cece. What?
this morning's message. You may be seated.
To live is Christ, to die is gain. It's a song is very scriptural. It's from Philippians chapter 1. Paul, in prison, speaks those words that to live is Christ, to die is gain. Just Friday, some of us went to say goodbye to a friend that passed away, a brother in the Lord. Larry Davis passed away. Some of you know him, some of you don't. And Larry, I would say, would probably, I know at this moment right now, he knows to live is Christ, to die is gain. He's experiencing the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ right now. We sing that song, and I know most of us mean it with all of our heart. To live is Christ, to die is gain. But if you're young and you got a lot of life ahead of you, you know, you don't want to die, you know. Nobody wants to die. We don't want to be morbid here. But it's a wonderful truth, right? Is it not, to know that if we were to die right now, we'd be in the presence of the Lord? To live is Christ. To die is gain. It's a wonderful, wonderful truth. And this morning, I'm going to do something a little different. We are in 1 Corinthians in our study time. But because I had a number of things on my plate this week with Larry passing away, we had a wonderful new membership class yesterday. I had four people that want to join the church. And so I decided to preach on the purpose of the Lord's Supper. Since today is the first Sunday of the month and we're going to be having the Lord's Supper, sometimes we can get into a rut. Right? We just do it. We don't even know why we're doing it. We just do it because, you know, that's what we're doing. And so I thought it would be good to always make sure that we, when we come together and have the Lord's Supper together, that we're making it meaningful. You know what I mean? We want to have a meaningful time of worship and not just have the Lord's Supper. And so I'm going to preach a short message on the purpose of the Lord's Supper. And then I will pray, and the deacons will come forward, and we're gonna go right into it, right after the message, right into the Lord's Supper, and worship the Lord, gathering together as a church around His table, and so that's what we're gonna look at this morning, the Lord's Supper. In a moment, I'm gonna read the scriptures here in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. I'm gonna read verses 23 to 34, but just wanna, you know, give you some heads up of where we're going with this message. Why do we have the Lord's Supper? Why do we have it? What does it mean? What does it mean to have the Lord's Supper? Can anybody partake of the Lord's Supper? And another question that I want to answer this morning in this morning's message is there any kind of a spiritual benefit? Is there any kind of spiritual benefit of partaking of the Lord's Supper? I don't think those are important questions to ponder, and I believe the scriptures do give us an answer. So if you have your Bible, join with me and listen to the reading of the Word, and I'm reading 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and I'm going to read verses 23 all the way down to verse 34. Hear the word of the Lord. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." Verse 27. "Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason, many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep. Now, he's not talking about physical sleep there. He's talking about death. Many are dying. Verse 31, for if we judge ourselves, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened by the Lord, that we may not be condemned with the world. Therefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. But if anyone is hungry, let him eat at home, lest you come together for judgment, and the rest I will set in order when I come. Will you join me in prayer? Lord God, we give you thanks and praise for this gathering. It's a small group of people that have come out this morning to worship you, Lord. Lord, you know everyone's heart here. And Lord, my desire is to make this a meaningful time. A meaningful time of worship and the hearing of your word. Oh, Lord, my God, Lord Jesus, I pray that your spirit would move in all of our hearts. Give us eyes to see, ears to hear, and a heart to understand the truth of thy word. May it be a fruitful and beneficial. May you be glorified. May you have your way in all of our hearts, and may we truly worship you, for you are worthy of all of our worship. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All righty. Well, for one thing I want to point out to you regarding the Lord's Supper, I believe the Lord's Supper is very important. And just by the very amount of attention, the amount of attention that the Lord's Supper gets, three of the four Gospels, the institution of the Lord's Supper is mentioned, that scene where Jesus is sitting down with his disciples and he's saying these words, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Three of the four Gospels record that scene, that event. And then here in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul is correcting the Corinthian church because they were abusing the Lord's Supper. And so if it's something that can be abused, done in the wrong way, that ought to tell us that it's a very important event, a very important act of worship for a church to participate in just by the very nature of the attention that it is given in the New Testament. And so I want to pose some questions. The first question I want to ask is, what is the Lord's Supper? What is the Lord's Supper? And the Lord's Supper, I believe, is four things. There's four things that I think that the Scriptures teach the Lord's Supper is. In the words that we have here before us, it says, Jesus says, do this in remembrance of me. Do this in remembrance of me. Now, the word ordinance is not in the Scriptures, but churches throughout history believe that the Lord's Supper and baptism are what is called an ordinance. And an ordinance is basically something that symbolizes the gospel, or it proclaims the gospel. And as I mentioned, baptism, the Lord's Supper as well, there are two ordinances that Christ gave to the church that preach the gospel. And you know, sometimes churches have a lot of drama. I'm not talking about gossip and stuff that are going on out there. I'm talking about drama up here where we have maybe a skit or a play that portrays, you know, something of a need that we have in our life spiritually. And I'm not against that kind of stuff. But if you want to see something portrayed in some drama, right, the Lord's Supper is actually art. It's portraying something. It's portraying what Jesus has done for us. So there's two ordinances that Christ gave to the church, baptism and the Lord's Supper. They both, listen to me, they both symbolize the gospel. the good news that Christ died for our sins, was buried, and he rose again on the third day. So let me break these two ordinances up and explain how they portray Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. For those of you who don't know, maybe you do know, baptism signifies the beginning of the believer's new life in Christ and the fact that they have been born again by the Spirit of God. And just as Christ died for their sin, the believer has also died to their own personal sin. Just as Christ was buried, when you're baptized, you are also being buried, as we have that tub that we have here when we baptize people. They are being buried as Christ was buried in the grave after he died. They are being buried in the water, immersed in the water, and identifying themselves with Jesus Christ. So they are identifying themselves in saying that I've died to my sin. I want to follow Christ. I'm being buried in the water as he was buried in the ground. And then when they come back up out of the water, they are signifying the new life that they have now, that Jesus is no longer dead, he is alive. And that's what the believer is saying, the new believer. He says, I'm no longer going to walk in my old ways. I'm alive now, and I want to follow Christ and be a different person, a newness of life. So baptism preaches the gospel. Therefore, it is an ordinance that the church ought to participate in. And so when someone's being baptized, you need to be here for that, because you are enjoying the very celebration of a person who's saying, I am no longer in this world, but I've now following Christ, and I'm a new believer, and you get to participate in that celebration. So baptism signifies the gospel. The Lord's Supper also signifies the gospel, and it does this. It shows the constant need that every believer has in Christ. It reveals that the believer has a need in Christ as the sustainer and provider of their spiritual life. Bread to eat and wine to drink. Now, because we are good Baptists, we don't use wine. We use juice, just so you know, all right? So the Lord's Supper signifies the gospel. It shows the believer's need to continually trust in Christ as the provider and the sustainer of their spiritual life. So not only is the Lord's Supper an ordinance, but it is also a celebration. We're celebrating something. Are you guys with me this morning? You're with me? Okay. It is a celebration. I need a couple amens every once in a while just to make sure everybody's with me, all right? The Lord's Supper is not only an ordinance, it is also a celebration. A celebration of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ on that cross, who died for our sins. And it is closely related to the celebration that the Jews do as well. The Jews also celebrate. They have a Passover meal. It's closely associated with the Lord's Supper. The Passover meal was celebrated by the Jewish people, and they celebrate it in memory of the Lord delivering them from the bondage that they had when they were in Egypt. Well, what kind of celebration do Christians celebrate? Well, the Christians should celebrate what Christ has done for them. That he delivered us, not from Egypt, but he has delivered us from our sin. We're no longer a slave to our sins. You don't have to live in sin. You choose to live in sin. Christ dying on the cross and you trusting in Jesus, he delivers you from your sin. You don't have to live in it any longer. It no longer controls your life. He not only delivered us from sin, but he also delivered us from Satan. Satan, who sways power and control over this world, when you trust in Jesus Christ and he delivers you from your sin, he also delivers you from Satan. He no longer has sway and control over your life. And lastly, we celebrate not only that he's delivered us from sin and Satan, but we also celebrate as Christians that he's delivered us from death. Oh, death, 1 Corinthians 15, where is your sting? Death has been defeated in that Christ died for our sins. The wages of our sin is death. Jesus took the death penalty. And so, yes, we will die. We will all experience a physical death. But when you go to a funeral, a believer's funeral especially, you're celebrating that that believer is not, that's not the end of his life or her life. They are now in the very presence of the Lord. Death has been defeated, amen? And so the believer can celebrate that they have been delivered from death. And so it is an ordinance, it is a celebration, but the Lord's Supper is portrayed in the four Gospels and as well here in 1 Corinthians as a memorial. It is something that we are remembering. So if you look at verses 24 and verse 25 of 1 Corinthians 11, twice Jesus says, do this, what? In remembrance of me. So twice Jesus is saying, do this in remembrance of me. And so the believer is remembering what Christ has done for them. We are remembering what he's done. So not only is the Lord's Supper an ordinance, not only is it a celebration, but it is also a memorial. We are remembering what Christ has done for us. And lastly, when we ask the question, what is the Lord's Supper? It is not only an ordinance, it's not only a celebration, it is a memorial, but lastly, the Lord's Supper is a commandment. Jesus is commanding his followers to do this in remembrance of me. Jesus is commanding the church to remember who he is and what he has done for them. So when we come together and we celebrate what Jesus has done for us, we are being obedient to the one who died for us. We are obeying his command. That is why, listen to me, that is why it is so important to have the Lord's Supper at a time where the majority of the church family can participate in it. You know why? Because that gives you an opportunity to show your love for Jesus. That gives you an opportunity to show your love for Jesus, that you want to obey his command to do this in remembrance of me. If we have the Lord's Supper in an isolated way, where we only let a few come, right? Then the majority of the church, maybe it doesn't fit their schedule, they have other things going on, they can't make it to that service. When we do the Lord's Supper in a way that opens it up to the majority of the church family to participate in the Lord's Supper, they are able to obey the Lord's command together as a church. So we as believers are called to be faithful, especially in our gathering together. In Hebrews chapter 10, it says that we should not forsake the assembling of ourselves together as some do, but we should be trying to find ways to exhort, to encourage one another. And so if that is the commandment for any of our gatherings, every Sunday we should not forsake that gathering together. This is much more upon the church, upon you as a believer, upon me, to want to come to the Lord's Supper because we know Jesus is commanding us to do it. And we want to be obedient to the Lord. So the Lord's Supper, this is going to be a quiz I'm going to give you later on. So make sure you're paying attention. Hope you're writing it down. Four things I said, right? The Lord's Supper is an ordinance. It is a celebration. It is a memorial. And it is a commandment. You tracking with me? I got you. I'm watching you. All right, you guys looking at me, you don't understand. I can see you too. Well, praise the Lord. I do want to have some fun. And, sometimes I come across like I'm a real serious guy. I am. But I also love Jesus. And I hope you love Jesus too. Hey, secondly, not only that is what the Lord's Supper is, here's a question I want to ask because I want to know this. So I studied it so I can help you understand it. What does the bread and the cup mean? What does the bread and the cup of blood mean? Well, there are many views throughout church history of what they mean. Two of the most popular ones, one of them is taught by the Catholic Church. And the Catholic Church have a theology called that when they view the Lord's Supper, the bread and the drink, the cup, and they call it transubstantiation. That is their theology. It's called transubstantiation. And what that means is this, that the bread and the wine are being transformed into the actual physical body of the Lord Jesus Christ. The outward present remains as bread and wine, but the inward reality or the substance is being changed. It's a hocus-pocus, alakazam kind of miracle that takes place every time the Catholic Church has communion. And so, in the Catholic view, those who are participating, they are literally receiving Christ himself, his body. They are literally receiving Christ himself. That means, in their view, that Jesus is being sacrificed over and over and over again. It is a bloodless sacrifice, but Jesus is being sacrificed over and over again. Well, the Protestant church, which we are a part of, we're not Presbyterian, we're Baptist, right? We're Christians. They just have a Baptist church. Understand that. Just nod your heads and we'll get done faster. All right. But we're from the Protestant revolt, from the Catholic Church, and so we are Protestants in that sense. We don't believe that the Bible teaches that, but teach that the bread and wine are only symbols of the body and the blood of the Lord. We believe that they are symbols and not really his body and not really his blood. Because when Jesus was holding the bread and holding the cup, he was saying, "This is my body. This is the cup." He did not actually die yet. He was foretelling of what was going to happen. He says, "This is my body." No, his body's over here, right? And he's saying, "This is my body, this is the cup." It wasn't literally becoming his body or literally becoming the cup of his blood. So that's one reason why I don't believe in that position. Secondly, the early church never seemed to practice communion in that way. And I know that because of what Paul's words are right here in our text, where he says in verse 26, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." So every time we partake of the Lord's Supper, we eat the bread and we drink of the cup, we are proclaiming. It's not literally becoming the body of Jesus and the blood of Jesus, but we're proclaiming. We're talking about Jesus. We're signifying the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. They are symbols of his body that was broken for us, his blood that was spilled for us. Jesus says that the bread is his body, which is broken for us, and the cup is the blood of his new covenant, which was shed for you and I. And so if this is true, that they're only symbols, and this is leading me to the spiritual significance of it, I do need to give you heads up. Maybe you're sitting here this morning and you have always thought that there's some kind of merit that you're gaining with God, that you are earning favor with God by partaking of the Lord's Supper, that it's somehow, some way, making you right with God, giving you forgiveness of your sin. Some people believe that, and that teaching of the Catholic Church has entered into some people's minds, maybe even here this morning, and I don't want to insult you in any way whatsoever, but you can never make yourself right with God by partaking of the Lord's Supper. If you are lost right now, if you are a lost sinner, separated from God because you've sinned against him, you're going to be a lost sinner separated from God after you partake of the Lord's Supper. It's not going to help you. It's not going to reconnect you to God so that he forgives you of your sins. You can do it over and over and over again. It will not wash away your sins. Just like baptism, right? You don't get baptized to wash away your sins. Your sins are already washed away. And so you are giving a picture of what happened already on the inside when you get baptized. Your sins have already been washed away when you put your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, and the water is portraying that your sins have been washed away and you are a new believer in Christ. So if partaking of the Lord's Supper cannot contribute to my salvation, Are you out there wondering then what kind of spiritual benefit is there from partaking of the Lord's Supper? And I'm glad you asked that question, because I have a few answers for you. Number one, in the words again, isn't it amazing how much truth you can get out of from one statement? He says, do this in remembrance of me. In those words, do this in remembrance of me, there is somewhat of an indictment given to every believer. It is saying, hey, you're a forgetful person. And are we not forgetful creatures? Do we not forget things over and over and over again? We are forgetful. And because we are still sinners, we are prone to wander, even though we are saved. And you can come to church every Sunday and hear gospel truth. You can hear things about how to be a better husband, how to witness, how to be a better wife, how to raise your kids, and you can learn all kinds of things, how to bear fruit for God, and all those are all good, important things. But one Sunday a month, when we do the Lord's Supper, we are focusing our complete attention on what Jesus has done for us, and we're remembering. You know, sometimes you can do a lot of Christian stuff and forget about Jesus. Isn't that true? Just forget about him. We're so used to, you know, being good. And the world does that, but why do we do what we do? We do it because of Jesus. And so we need to be reminded. And so the Lord, in his mercy, has provided for our sanctification in that we can press the pause button in our busy, busy life of just doing Christian things and reflect on what Jesus has done for us on that cross, and worship him and remember him for what he's done for us on that cross. There's another way to answer this question. That is to compare the baptism and the Lord's Supper, which are two ordinances that are given to the church. Again, baptism is a one-time event that a believer does when they're a new believer. They partake in baptism. He or she, again, is saying that as they are being baptized, I'm a follower of Christ. I believe that he died for my sins, and he was buried and risen from the dead. Baptism symbolizes what Christ has done for us. The believer is commanded to be baptized to begin his or her life as a follower of Christ. Through baptism, the believer is symbolizing that he is united, or she is united, to Christ. Now listen to how Romans 6 puts this. Romans chapter 6, verses 3 and 4. Or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? You're uniting yourself with Jesus' death. Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. I usually quote that verse when I am baptizing somebody. The Lord's Supper is not in the same way. So it's a one-time event. You don't get baptized over and over and over again. You do it once, and it's a picture of what Christ has done for you. The Lord's Supper is done over and over and over again. Why? Why do we keep doing it? Well, listen. Jesus could have chosen any kind of elements, but he chose bread and he chose wine for a reason. We eat bread. We drink wine. Well, you know what I mean, right? Juice. Man, I feel like a punk, you know what I'm saying? No. Listen, and so there's a renewal of the believer's commitment to Christ, and it's an ongoing renewal. Every time we partake of the Lord's Supper, those two elements that he's chosen to use are significant. They preach what he's done for us. His body was broken. The blood was spilled out of his body. They signify that. The difference is that baptism is the beginning of one's life, And it signifies the believer's commitment to Christ, his new life, his justification. But the Lord's Supper symbolizes the believer's need for complete dependence on Christ as the sustainer and provider of the believer's life. Just think about bread and wine. They're things that we need for our body, and they are giving us things, nourishment and sustaining our body. And in a spiritual way, we are telling Christ that we need him. In a spiritual way, we are reaching out to the Lord and saying, Lord, by partaking of this, I am telling you that you are the bread of my life, that you died for my sins, and I can't live my life without you. I need you. And so I'm putting my trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, faith is so important. Faith is so important in both ordinances. I mean, when you're getting baptized, the water's not going in and washing away your sins in any way, right? But you're putting your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, that baptism is signifying what Jesus has done for you. In the same way, we might not understand everything about the Lord's Supper, but Jesus says, do this in remembrance of me, the bread and the wine. We still need to put our trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, that this bread is nourishment for our souls. This wine is providing for my spiritual need. They're not really literally doing that, but we're putting our trust in the words of the Lord Jesus and showing our complete dependence on him. So therefore, if either of these ordinances are not done in faith, and it's just done in motion, so in other words, if you don't come to the Lord in faith, trusting that this is a spiritual benefit for me, and I'm showing you, I'm renewing my commitment to you, I'm telling you that I need you, Jesus. If you are not putting your faith in the Lord in that way, then you're just going through the motions. And then, therefore, the spiritual benefit is nullified. It's nullified. It's not going to do you any good. See, every time we put our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, something is happening in our life. We are being sanctified. As we put our trust in the Lord, we might not understand a lot of things the Bible says, but as we believe what he says and we live it out in our life, we are being sanctified. We're becoming more like Jesus. Every time we exercise our faith, we are growing in the Lord. And so what a joy we have to participate in the Lord's table. As we gather together, we are obeying him and given that ability to grow in our relationship with the Lord. And there is one more thing to consider regarding the spiritual benefit for us. I want you, if you turn back in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 16 and following, the Word of God says here, and many theologians do not completely understand what Paul means through these words, but we're going to take a little stab at it, okay? Listen. The cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? For we, though many, are one bread and one body, for we all partake of that one bread. Observe Israel after the flesh, observe Israel after the flesh, are not those who eat of the sacrifices partakers of the altar? What am I saying? I'm wondering the same thing. That an idol is anything? Or what is offered to idols is anything? Rather, that the sacrifice, that the things which the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to demons and not to God. And I do not want you to have fellowship with demons. It's like being a father to children, right? You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You cannot partake of the Lord's table and the table of demons. Or do we provoke the Lord to jealousy? Are we stronger than he? There's a lot going on there, right? And when we get to this chapter, we're going to get into detail. But I want to point out that he is calling this the cup of blessing, that it is a communion of the blood and body, and the bread is the communion of the body of Christ. And as I said, most theologians don't understand. There's a mystery being spoken here. John Calvin, the great theologian himself, as he writes his commentary on 1 Corinthians, doesn't know exactly what Paul is saying here. But we do know we can learn from something. There's a word in here. That word communion is the Greek word for what we look at, the word koinonia. Those of you who are familiar with that word in Philippians, fellowship. Fellowship. That's usually translated fellowship. And although we don't know exactly what he's saying here, listen to me. There is a spiritual blessing for the believer in partaking of the Lord's Supper, in that the church is enjoying the very presence of the Lord. The cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the fellowship of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the fellowship of the body of Christ? And so we're gathering together and we're having a real spiritual fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ in a special way. There is a spiritual fellowship as we partake of the supper. And Paul says to the church at Corinth, listen to this. This is why I know it's important. That they cannot participate in the pagan festivals because they are sacrificing those to demons and partake of the Lord's Supper at the same time. Again, look at verses 21 and 22. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You cannot partake of the Lord's table and the cup and the table of demons. Or do we provoke the Lord to jealousy? And so they were trying to have this worship time together with their pagan festivals and the Lord's table at the same time. He said, no, you can't do that. Because when we are gathered together and we are partaking of the Lord's table, there's a real, genuine, true fellowship of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, he's not physically present here. He says, you keep doing this, the Lord's Supper, and someday we're going to do it together in heaven and we'll physically be with him. But for now, there's a spiritual presence in a real way of fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ every time we partake of the Lord's Supper. Amen? And so therefore, he says, don't partake of this demonic act of worship together with what we're doing here as a church, because you cannot do that. You're provoking the Lord to jealousy. That's what their problem was, and we're not doing that today. And so there's a spiritual benefit in the fact that we are truly, and I hope you believe this. And again, it's an act of faith. You have to believe what God is saying here. That we are truly fellowshipping with the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, as I bring this message to a close, the last thing I just want to survey here for us is what kind of spirit, what kind of motivation should we have as we partake of the Lord's table? Some consider it like we're almost at a funeral. There's a sober spirit. And, no joy, no happiness. We're like, everybody sit still and we're going to all stand at the same time. We're all going to kneel at the same time. We're all going to, it's real somber, right? Now, I'm not totally against that because Jesus died for our sins. And so as we partake of the Lord's Supper, we ought to pause and consider what it means for Jesus hanging on a cross for us. There is an attitude of repentance that we need to have as we partake of the Lord's Supper. Jesus died for our sins. We need to contemplate and do some soul searching and some repenting. We are, listen to me, we are to judge ourselves. We're pretty good at judging other people, are we not? You need to nod your head on that one. We are really good at that. But instead, we need to judge ourselves. That's what he says here. We verse 31, for if we judge ourselves, we would not be judged. God wants us to judge ourselves prior to coming to the Lord's Supper. There is a judgment. And so there's a danger, and I'm trying to land this plane here. There is a danger in partaking of the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner. And that's what he says there. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty. No, he's speaking to the church. You're the church. And so there's a danger there of partaking of the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner. And so therefore we ought to judge ourselves. A lack of discernment or a low understanding of the body of Christ that was broken for us and the blood that was spilled for us is heading into dangerous, treacherous waters of partaking of the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner. So let me just give you a few things. If you are here this morning and you are an unbeliever, you've never turned from your sins, you've never put your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you think somehow partaking of the Lord's Supper will contribute to your salvation, I'm here to tell you that that would be partaking of the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner, because it cannot wash away your sins. It cannot earn merit with God. So I would recommend that you do not partake in that way. Secondly, a believer can partake of the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner if they are living in unrepented, unconfessed sin. Now, having said that, as I always say to you, we as Christians, we are not hopeless. You understand that? If you have a struggle with something in your life, you don't have to live that way. There is hope for the Christian. You are one confession away of being renewed in your heart and life to be able to walk with the Lord the way He wants you to. It might not be easy, but it's not hopeless. You understand what I'm saying? And so if that's your case, if you realize that you have unrepented, unconfessed sin, and you know it, and you're sitting here this morning, the Lord's Supper is a great time to get right with God, to renew your commitment that you said, I believe in you, Jesus, and I want to follow you with my life, but you've allowed sin. You've been entangled with sin, and you can't run the race anymore. And so you need to confess that to God. He's faithful and just to forgive you and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. He'll do that right now. That's why the Lord's Supper is good, because it causes us to say, hey, Lord, I'm sorry, Lord, please forgive me. And the moment you ask for forgiveness, He forgives you. A believer who has unrepented, unconfessed sin, they should not partake because they are not seeing their sin as God sees it. Sin is a bad, bad thing. Jesus died for our sins. An unworthy manner could also be if you are unloving toward another brother or sister. In the context here, the first early church would not only have the Lord's Supper with bread and wine, but they would also have a meal. And sometimes that they would bring those two together and they were being unloving to each other. That's what's happening in the Corinthian church. And so if you have been unloving to your wife or to your son or your daughter or your brother or sister here in the church, you need to make amends. You need to talk to that person and not come to the Lord's table in an unworthy. So he says, examine yourself. Examine yourself. Before you partake of the Lord's Supper, you ought to pause. You ought to pray. You ought to ask the Lord to search your heart and see, is there any sin in my life, Lord, that I have not confessed to you? Seek His forgiveness and He will forgive you. Seek forgiveness of those you might have offended. Accept their forgiveness and don't live in guilt. So in faith, accept God's forgiveness. Partake of the Lord's table. And so there is a spirit of somber and soberness and seriousness. But having said that, there's another way we ought to partake of the Lord's Supper, and that is one of joy, of celebration, because Jesus is our Savior, and He died for our sins. He was buried, and we're forgiven of our sins, and we're not on our way to hell. We're on our way to heaven, and one day we're going to see Jesus face to face. Jesus is going to return. He's going to be in the skies, up in the clouds, and we're going to see Him face to face, and He's going to transform our bodies into glorious bodies. Amen. Hallelujah. And so every time we celebrate the Lord's table and we partake of it, we are saying, Jesus, you're going to come back. And we're celebrating the Lord's return. And so it is a celebration that we can do in both ways. We can remember what He's done for us, but we can also look forward to the day He's going to gloriously rapture the church and we're going to be in heaven with Him someday. Amen? And so it's a wonderful time to gather together. And so I pray that God's word this morning is truly a blessing to you, to prepare your hearts as we are gathering together this morning to partake of the Lord's table. I meant for us to learn today a theology, in a sense, a theology of the Lord's Supper. What does it mean? What kind of spiritual benefit is it? And I hope you caught some of it and that it's beneficial as we are going to prepare our hearts now to partake of the Lord's Supper, that you can reflect. It might be a simple cracker. It might be just a cup full of juice, right? But it's meaningful, and I hope it's meaningful to you. Amen. I'm going to close in prayer, and as I'm praying, I want my deacons to come up, and as I'm praying, they can come up, and the men who they've picked to help serve can also gather in their position. And as I'm praying, why don't you take that time as well to pray and prepare your heart to receive fellowship with the Lord around the table. Let's pray. As you're sitting in your seat and contemplating your relationship with the Lord, regardless of where you're at spiritually, you are one prayer away from your life being changed. If you're here this morning and you're not a believer, perhaps you're a seeker, perhaps you're struggling in believing. If Christ has revealed himself to you as the Savior of the world, your Savior, you can call out to him right where you're sitting and ask him to save you. With a repentant heart, put your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. And today can be a day of celebration for you. And today you can partake of the Lord's Supper. And if you're a believer and struggling, talk to the Lord this morning. Confess, repent, renew your commitment to him. Jesus, we are your people. We are your sheep. And we gather together this morning to worship you around your table. It is your table. And you invite all those who know you, all of your children who have put their faith in you, to gather around the table and to do this in remembrance of you. And so I pray for that this morning, that we would all worship you in a meaningful way, remembering what Christ, our Savior, has done for us. This I pray in Jesus' name. an interesting verse that I read in the context here of 1 Corinthians 11 that I never saw before until I was studying for this message. It says, therefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. That's a good reason why we're not, no one's just doing this by themselves. Or are anybody out there doing it by themselves? No. So we're going to do it together, right? And so Brother Glenn's going to pray, and then I'm going to read the scripture, and each time we'll do it together. So, Glenn.
Father, we come together to remember what Christ did for us. We come together to proclaim his death. We come together, Lord, to honor and glorify him for his sacrifice on the cross, for his breaking of his body, for the shedding of his blood. Lord, we
feel the same way the way you feel about sin? To want to live our lives for you, to be the light of the world, to be more loving toward one another. Give us eyes to see those who are around us, maybe even in our presence today, that need a caring word, a hug, help with groceries, help paying bills, or a way we can reflect and show love toward one another. May today be a wonderful day of celebrating the forgiveness of sins that we have because of our King, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, because of Jesus. Amen. So y'all can stand up and we're going to sing a wonderful song. Amen.
Amen.